On This Week in Enterprise Tech, a Sharknado in data lakes, big data use big rigs, and Steve Gibson drops by to show you why JavaScript is going to start World War III. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 139, recorded May 8th, 2015, The Next Generation of DDoS. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire. The right candidate fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. Welcome to Twyatt This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But of course, I'm not guiding you by myself. I've got my good friends and colleagues, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii, the geek in paradise. How is paradise?
Paradise is currently rainy, and I'm going out of my mind getting ready for the Honolulu Mini Maker Fair, which is noon to 5 p.m. tomorrow at Iolani School.
Hopefully it's not raining on your maker parade, but someone who is also very accustomed to rain, I'm not sure if it's raining over there right now, but it should be, Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, are you home now, or are you still back on the road?
This is the first Friday in a month when I've been coming to you from the studio in the swamp, and it feels good to be home. Well, and it's not rainy here in Florida. It's actually a lovely, lovely day of sunshine, puffy white clouds, and low 80s.
Well, we'll fix that in just a sec. Now, gents, it's a big show. We've got a lot of information packed into our segments here, so let's go ahead and kick it off with some blips. This first one, well, it brings back a little bit of nostalgia because Generation Cisco is all grown up. Microsoft, Oracle, Intel, IBM, the companies most responsible for the IT generation in which we now live, have all seen their elder statesmen, leaders, and CEOs step down or step aside. And now, perhaps the last of the old guard, John Chambers of Cisco Systems, joins them in twilight. Earlier this week, Chambers announced that he would step down as chief executive, allowing Charles Robbins, a longtime Cisco sales exec, to take the helm of the networking giant. CEO since 1995, Chambers has overseen Cisco through the internet boom, bust, boom again, and finally a maturing of the IT generation. In that time, he has seen Cisco rise from $1.2 billion in annual sales to more than $47.1 billion in 2014, and from $10 billion in market cap to $740 billion at the peak of the bubble to its current $150 billion valuation.
It's a milestone. Healthcare data breaches from cyber attacks and criminals eclipse employee error for the first time. Cyber attacks and physical criminal activity now have officially surpassed insider negligence as the main cause of a data breach in healthcare organizations. The Ponemon Institute's fifth annual benchmark study on privacy and security of healthcare data found that close to 45% of all data breaches in healthcare are due to criminal activity, a 125% increase in such activity over the past 5 years. The cost of all this healthcare breach mania? Some $6 billion per year, that's with a B, with an average cost of $2.1 million per healthcare organization, according to the report. Why hit healthcare? The bad guys are after insurance information for insurance fraud, as well as employee data from the healthcare providers. We've seen a huge increase in abuse of employee data, an ID theft expert said. In the last month and a half, we've seen a 100% increase in tax fraud.
Google, Twitter, and Red Hat speak up for container standards. So while Docker has gained significant ground in the industry, the big boys are calling for support of the new APPC, or App Container Emerging Standard, as part of the Core OS movement. So while these giants have previously supported the Docker movement, it's unsure whether APPC and Docker will merge standards or become separate in the future. Whichever wins, the ability to support containers in general is sure to become part of your future data center plans.
This past week, a milestone was reached in the nexus of the Internet of Things, big data, and automated vehicles. A single long-haul rig, a Daimler Freightliner Inspiration, was adorned with a license plate that marked it as the first officially recognized self-driving truck in the nation. Kinda. The Inspiration will only drive autonomously on the highways, and its programming will not allow it to pass vehicles on its own. Stereoscopic cameras and a set of short and long-range radar will scan forward up to 800 feet for obstacles and hazards. Though this test vehicle will not include LiDAR or vehicle-to-vehicle communications, the Inspiration itself is designed to be connected to a vast network control system, not only marking location and status of the fleet, but to eventually be an integral part of a just-in-time inventory system. In other words, big data just got a big rig.
Is it super silicon? Intel Xeon E7v3 chip is designed for business intelligence and big data. The new Intel Xeon processor E7-8800/4800V3 product families, boy, that's a mouthful, is the fastest processor for data analytics and not too shabby on engineering, scientific, and other workloads either. This is according to Intel. Available with up to 18 cores, the Xeon E7v3 boosts performance while cutting power requirements compared to its predecessors. Real-time business intelligence and analytics have become a top priority as the time to market has shrunk from years to months, and the flood of big data has created a deluge overwhelming traditional data centers. For maxed-out configurations, the E7v3 supports 32 sockets, each with 18 cores, for 567-core clusters housing the largest in-memory and fast solid-state drive mass storage options available today. Want to buy your own? Prices for the Xeon E7v3 range from $1,224, that's $1,224, to $7,175 each in quantities of 1,000.
Well, Samsung and the University of Texas at Austin propose a GPS augmentation system for millimeter position resolution. Previously, millimeter position resolution has required large amounts of processing power for differential GPS. The University of Texas at Austin is teaming up with Samsung to create an augmented GPS standard that can provide ultra-precise positioning without the huge overhead of differential GPS. The idea of combining GPS with other terrestrial signal sources like CDMA is not new, but this new system could potentially really make outdoor augmented reality very real with proposed snap-ons to some existing mobile devices.
T-Mobile has pushed hard to be known as the Uncarrier, but it seems that the Uncarrier is unprofitable. T-Mobile has been fantastically disruptive in the wireless space over the past 3 years. T-Mobile's Uncarrier deals have included features like free international roaming, free in-flight connectivity, unmatched prepaid plans that have made bring-your-own-device far less painful, as well as gimmicks like paying off competing carriers' early termination fees, smartphone loans, and free streaming media. Those features have endeared T-Mobile to its guerrilla wireless warriors, but have not been so great for the bottom line. T-Mobile has been expanding its capital expenditures by $1.7 billion since starting Uncarrier, and many analysts see an end coming, either in a merger or a dropping of the features. Here's hoping that doesn't happen because T-Mobile's initiatives have kept pressure on the other three wireless carriers who have been dragged kicking and screaming into an Uncarrier-like feature of their own. That does it for the blips. Let's go ahead and move into the bites. Now, gentlemen, this first one, I don't really have an end game for. It's just something that struck me. I heard this at Interop. I heard this at Enterprise Connect. I've heard this in a couple of private briefings that we're moving from the idea of data warehousing to a new idea of data lakes. Now, data lakes has really become part of our terminology probably since, I'd say, June of 2014. Specifically, I want to talk about how in a traditional big data organization, we used to talk about storing data in a data warehouse. And a data warehouse had a very specific hierarchy. You wanted to separate the data. You wanted to categorize it so that when you were to access it with a relational database, it would make it easy for you to come up with some sort of conclusion, some sort of analysis. But we've been moving from that sort of static, solid, traditional huge data warehouse idea into this idea of a data lake. Chiebert, what is a data lake? How does it differ from a data warehouse?
Splish, splash, I'm taking a bath. You know, this is sounding awful familiar, like Horst Schelling from Hit Solutions. This is kind of almost what he was describing. You know, it's no longer I've got to have the data always online, always available. It's I need to be able to get to it within a reasonable amount of time. I've been hearing people use data lakes, but I've been hearing for every person I've talked to a different definition. I think this is one of those terminologies that hasn't quite gelled yet. But people are no longer going, I have to have it always online. It's more along the lines of, I'm going to start segmenting my storage so that I have larger amounts of nearline storage that isn't quite as fast, but I need access to once in a while. So I'm going to go with a data lake being something you have to walk to and, you know, maybe row out into middle lake to get to, but it's still available close by.
Right. Well, there's definitely that storage aspect to the whole data warehouse to data lake idea, because the fundamental idea behind the data lake is rather than taking data and putting into preset categories, you store everything, no matter whether or not you know it's going to be useful in the future. That really does change how we store things, and it also changes how we analyze things. One of the biggest uses of data lakes has been the growing trend for Hadoop. So, of course, I got to throw it over to you, Curtis. Hadoop has been very good at using both traditional data sets and what they've come to call data lakes, which are non-traditional third-party little bits and pieces of information that may not have an overall category or subheading, but nonetheless can be used in a relational database like Hadoop. Have you seen the data lakes conversation pick up at all on Information Week Radio?
You know, we have seen it on Information Week Radio, and we've talked about it a couple of times there. We're going to be talking about it more because it's getting more exciting, because data lakes are inherently part of the whole big data conversation. Now, big data lakes, by their nature, are unstructured, or at least a variety of different structures. You know, you can have traditional structured data, you can have completely unstructured data, you can have data in various quantities. The idea is that it's all thrown into this giant lake, which you can go and dip into later. This also gets into the idea for both storage and analytics of data tiering. You know, we hear a lot about that for a bunch of reasons, but, you know, traditionally, hot data is the data that you need on a moment-by-moment basis, and then you go through various degrees of, you know, warm, lukewarm, tepid, whatever, until you get to cold data, and that's data that you keep around, but you know that if you need it, you're going to have some warning, so you have time to either mount it if you're all the way back on tape, or at the very least, send a program out to fetch it and bring it back into a more normalized structure if you need to work on it. Data lakes are cold storage. Data lakes are things that you know you're not going to try to do a give me an answer in 2 minutes operation on. The nice thing is, it is data that we're collecting and really keeping for future analysis. You know, maybe it's a case where we don't know what analytical techniques we might use on it. We may even admit that we don't currently have the right analytical techniques to use on it, but we have faith that we will in the future. The danger of data lakes is security, because this is a bunch of information that we're keeping out there, and traditionally cold storage tends not to get the attention that hot storage does. So it's very much a complicated scenario, and it's complicated in huge, vast quantities of data.
I don't want to go any further down this rabbit hole, because the chat room is already breaking out data lakes into data mud puddles, data skating rinks, data curated ocean. So let's go ahead and move on. And actually, I want to move on to something that you can lead, Curtis, because you were at SAP Saphire, And one of the topics at SAP Saphire, in fact, one of the biggest ones, was this idea of the HANA Hadoop continuum, which, of course, is what we're talking about, relational data here. Can you tell us a little bit about what came out of SAP Saphire?
Well, there was a bunch coming out. Now, the one thing that did not come out this year was the announcement of some big new product. That's because the big new product, that's SAP S/4HANA, was announced back in February. So what we're hearing right now is about the first customers who are implementing projects and the applications that are being built on top of the package. One of the things that they were talking about, though, was the Internet of Things and big data. Now, if you don't know, HANA is SAP's in-memory computing platform. In other words, you bring whatever data you're going to analyze into RAM. The good news is that it's very, very fast. As Hasso Plattner talked about, effectively zero response time. In other words, you ask the question and the hardware doesn't get in the way. Your answer is essentially instantaneous. The bad news is that DRAM, compared to other kinds of storage, is really, really expensive. And so, for example, if you need to keep, oh, let's call it 700 terabytes or so in memory, well, you're going to write a check for about $20 million for the hardware to let you do so. What SAP has realized is if they need a way to get at very large stores of data, this data is typically managed under Hadoop. So what they did announce were some connectors between HANA and Hadoop, some ways of either using HANA to process the information that goes into a Hadoop data store, or HANA is used for the application that draws upon information that's kept in Hadoop, bringing it back into memory for the time that it's processed, then flushing it back out to Hadoop when it's not. It's a real recognition that there are limits to just how big a check customers can write, and frankly, to just how big a system the current generation of processors and memory can support. It's critical, it's fast, and it's allowing HANA to be used for a bunch of different applications that just weren't possible even a couple of years ago.
Right. Now, can you give a general overview of what SAP Saphire is supposed to be? For the people who are just listening to this now and going, wait, it was just a bunch of Hadoop people gathering, or it was just a bunch of HANA people gathering?
No, SAP Saphire is the annual global meeting of the Saphire, not Saphire, the SAP user group. It's a joint thing of Saphire, the SAP sponsored, and in the case of Orlando, ASUG, the America's SAP user group. It is thousands upon thousands of people, all SAP users, who gather to talk to one another, to go to a lot of conference sessions on the use of SAP, and to get inspired. I mean, there are keynotes by the CEO of SAP, by the CTO was there, and of course, by the grand old man of SAP himself, Hasso Plattner. It really is interesting to be there. This is about my seventh or eighth year going to Saphire, because you get a sense of exactly what people are doing with it. And if your sense of SAP is just, you know, old accounting and resource management software, people are using this platform for much, much more. It really is an amazingly powerful analytical platform, and there's some fascinating uses being made of the technology.
Now, it's interesting that you would bring up HANA and Hadoop. Obviously, they want a continuum there because, as you said, they want something for every company to be able to write a check for, not just the largest. But is this just a co-opting of the Hadoop community? I know SAP is really good with managing relational databases, but I remember when we first started talking about Hadoop way back at the start of TWiET, it was, well, is this going to replace SAP?
Well, it's not going to replace SAP. They fundamentally do a couple of different things. Hadoop is superb at providing tools that let you manage immense data stores and at managing immense unstructured data stores. HANA, the in-memory piece, and let's be really clear. HANA is a database platform. SAP S4 runs on top of HANA, but HANA is the database piece of what SAP does. HANA is all about in-memory computing. And as such, it does away with things like the vast indices that most databases have had to use for performance reasons. You don't have to do the accumulated roll-ups, basically the subsets of data that SAP always required in the past. The whole notion of HANA is that it is one database basically working with some fairly well-structured data that allows you to get at that data very, very rapidly. So you have, if you will, a sports car, the HANA platform, and the dump truck, Hadoop, actually a fleet of dump trucks. So what the SAP engineers have done is figure out a way to transfer information, data, from that fleet of dump trucks into the race car when it's needed. It's also kind of neat coming out of the information of things. When you have tons of sensor data, there's also now a way using a technique that they call streaming to run the data through HANA, not necessarily storing it in HANA, but run it through a HANA-based application to decide where it should be stored, whether it should be in a Hadoop database or perhaps in some part of HANA. You know, they really are figuring out that with these vast quantities of data, in order to make it useful, they have to figure out where data is best stored. Tiering is replacing some of the data layout issues as the main concern of database administrators these days, and it's keeping them just as busy as the old disk layout questions ever did.
We are going to have to move on because our audience, they're starting to spin a little bit. We do have an episode of TWiET coming up that is dedicated to relational databases. So we're going to be bringing on some experts, and hopefully they'll be able to untease some of these items. Now, when we come back, we're going to be dealing with a little bit of interop. We've got some video from Synology. Maybe they've got your next small to medium business or maybe even enterprise level backup NAS. And then we're going to be bringing in Steve Gibson. That's right, our security guru for everything. But before we do that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the sponsor of this episode of This Week at Enterprise Tech. And of course, it's got to be ZipRecruiter. Now, consider this. Your business is only as good as the people who work for you. If you don't get the right employees, and I'm not talking just about the right skill sets, but the right culture, the right person for the job and the position and the company culture itself, well, you just can't meet your potential. The problem is that the old method of posting in one place just isn't enough to get you those good people, that the people that your business deserves. You need to cast a wide net to ensure that you're getting the best candidates, and you need to put your posting in places where you'll find the candidates who are right for your company. That's why we're proud to have ZipRecruiter as part of the TWiET Riot. ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place isn't enough to find those candidates. That's why they let you post to 100-plus job sites with a single click. ZipRecruiter will help you find candidates in any city, any industry, nationwide. Just post once, and within 24 hours, watch your candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. Better yet, because you're a loyal listener of TWiET, try it for free. Do it today. Getting the right people for your company is so important that it's time to do it right, to do it quickly, to do it with ZipRecruiter. Try ZipRecruiter today with a free 4-day trial and get your perfect candidate before they go to somebody else by going to ZipRecruiter.com/TWiET. That's ZipRecruiter.com/TWiET. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, just after this, we're going to be bringing in Steve Gibson. He's going to be discussing the next generation of DDoS attacks. But before we do that, here's a little word from Interop. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit for Twit TV. I'm here at Interop 2015 in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm at the Synology booth. Now, you probably have seen a lot of Synology on Twit TV. We've reviewed their NAS, and we've even reviewed their partners. This is an IOSafe, which is essentially taking one of their high-powered NASs and putting it in an armored box. Well, to talk about what Synology is doing here at the show, I'm standing next to Mr. Franklin Hua, who's going to explain what Synology is going to do for your storage. Franklin, thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you, Father. What we're doing, we're showcasing here is we got a couple of partners right here. Again, you did mention the fireproof, waterproof, and DDoS enclosures by IOSafe. We also have our Seagate partner right here, Seagate. They make great enterprise NAS class drives. Those are the drives I would personally recommend you use when you want to deploy storage. Don't look at anything else. You're probably going to look at Seagate enterprise NAS class drives. But let's take a look at what else we're going to showcase here at Synology. Let's take a walk over here. And right here, as you can see right here, we're demonstrating our high-end business systems right here. This is the Synology RS106 13XS Plus. It has been configured to have high availability. So I got unit A right here, unit B right here, and it's configured for high availability in the back. So I got two interconnect links in the back. It has high availability functions. And taking a look right here, this is the Synology DSM operating system. It is a web-based GUI, so you can access it from Firefox, Internet Explorer, Chrome, and Safari, all the major web browsers, every single major operating system out there, Mac, Windows, Linux, computers. As you can see right here, I have high availability being demonstrated, but Docker is a method of virtualization. So this is a peek into the future of computing, into the future of network attached storage, where we can virtualize and host many different types of apps right here. You can take a look with the Docker repository. You can virtualize a whole operating system right this way. So this is the future, but let's talk about the basics. Synology is network attached storage. You can do, it supports all the major protocols of AFP, FTP, Samba SIFS, NFS, iSCSI. We have 10 gig in the back. You can support SAP, LC, and RJ45 over 10 gig. And then, of course, we got high availability. Now, this particular model with the RS106 13XS Plus, you can scale up to 106 bays worth of storage. That is up to 636 terabytes of raw storage capacity right there.
You know, one of the things that I really like about the entire range of Synology products is if you were using a 213,
yes,
and you stepped up to, say, the IOSafe 1513 Plus or 1515,
sure,
it's the same operating system. It's the same feel to it, but there is so much functionality. We have tested this on Before You Buy. We've shown it off on Twiet. Hands down, it's the fastest NAS that we've ever used. I know Patrick Norton highly recommends them.
Yep.
In making that transition from the nice, comfortable boxes that are sitting on desks to the rack-mounted units, what did Synology have to change?
Synology didn't really change anything. All we did is that we just took the hardware that was from the desktop-based system, desktop-based solutions, and we just made it rack mount. The operating system experience is identical. So you're getting the same functionality where you're looking at desktop or rack mount. You still have, you're looking at the business series, like say going from the 1515 Plus to the AXS Plus series, you still have the same business level functionality. You still get high availability. You still get iSCSI storage acceleration. You still get VEI. You still get ODX. You have all those same capabilities with the large boys right there.
I have a worked with a few people who use some of your higher-end NASs to back up EMC-level hardware. And what they've told me is, I want to buy a $20,000 solution, I can get something that's fast, something that I know is going to work every single time, and it's going to cost less than the licensing fee for backup that I would get from my primary vendor. Are you seeing a lot of that movement at Synology?
We are definitely seeing that level of movement. I have a couple of customers that I'm aware of. Like, I have a guy that's, he's in New Jersey. He has a seven-figure dollar SAN. And of course, any good CEO probably won't authorize another seven-figure dollar budget to handle that backups. So he looked around, he leaned on Synology, so we spec'd him out a 106 13XS Plus, 8 expansion units, and 106 4-terabyte drives. I gave him 300 terabytes of effective storage on his network so he can do on-site backup of his SAN. He did deploy a custom Mac computer to handle the interface between the two systems, but this is how Synology can fit the needs of larger deployments out there. You don't need to have another identical seven-figure SAN to handle your backups. You can look at Synology and Synology solutions. When you want to max out the storage capacity, the budget is well worth under six figures right there.
Now let's go ahead and move on to the one last thing. You don't have to have an enterprise system. You don't have to have a rack mount to get some Synology quality. Tell me a little bit about the products that you've got laid out right in front of me here.
So what we're looking at right here, we got Synology has a wide range of products depending on how much storage and capacity do you need. Right here, we're showcasing a few of our solutions. You got the DS214. This is great for your small office, home office. That's basically between 30 to 50 users right here. Here, I can let me step right over here. If this is okay, yeah, okay. So this is great for like your 30 user office or home office. This is really great for that. We got something small. This is the DS414 Slim. It is Synology's 2.5-inch bay NAS. It is great for if you care about silence and if you care about really quiet or low power operations, the DS414 Slim is great for that. We got the DS415 Play. These are great for those home environments that you're concerned about transcoding. You want to access your videos via your mobile device. You can use Synology Video Station and do up to 1080p transcoding that way. We got a two-bay scalable solution right here. This is the DS713 Plus, highest performance two-bay that's scalable. And of course, we got a rack mount solution right here, which we were looking up front right over there. This is our 10613XS Plus right here being demonstrated.
If you could, just could you please tell our audience where they could go on the internet to find more about Synology, to find more about the products, and find more about what you've released here at Interop?
So for any of our customers, any of our users that want to learn more about Synology, just check out the website, www.synology.com. All of our information is right there. You can click on the Where to Buy page. If you're interested in buying a unit, just go to the Where to Buy page. You can buy one right there. Or if you're looking at, you want someone to help you deploy the solution in your business environment, we have our reseller page right there. Just look for our Synology Gold Partners. That's where if you need help to have someone come on site and help you deploy the solution, check out our reseller page right there.
Franklin, thank you so very much for talking to us. Thank you for sharing the word about Synology, and you stay tabbed because we're bringing you more from Interop 2015.
I do want to apologize to the audience. I just realized I played that interview at 3x normal speed. So to Franklin, he doesn't normally speak that quickly. Actually, he does. He's very excited about his product. Now, Chiebert, one of the things we're going to be bringing some of the Synology guys in studio for is to show off Docker, because they were one of the first to bundle Docker compatibility on all of their hardware. You were playing with it a little bit at Interop. How much of a game changer is it?
Well, instead of, it basically comes down to bringing virtualization to the small and medium-sized business. That's kind of the spin I'm going for. Docker as a standard, having more compatibility across various virtualization systems is a wonderful thing. And, we did the blip on that. But having the ability to put in specialized appliances, being able to go and, put a containerized Linux machine into a small business without having to go and support, say, a server with 1,200 watts of power supply can make a pretty big difference in your operational costs. And it's also, theoretically, a lot easier to do because then you don't have to deal with a lot of the hardware abstraction that you have on full-size servers.
Right. And one of the things that I spoke with Franklin, in fact, I believe the two of us were there, we spoke to him about the use of more and more of these systems, especially the rack mount systems, in enterprises, maybe not as mainline storage, but as backup storage. And in his words, we've got clients who decide that they want to have the same amount of storage that they have from their big name enterprise class storage solution from NetApp or from EMC, but they find that they can get a NAS of equal size for less than the licensing fee of the backup software from NetApp or EMC. And that's more common, right? I mean, if you can get a NAS with dual 10 gigabit Ethernet interfaces, that can handle all your backup needs without having to spend seven digits for yet another big iron storage system.
Oh, you bet. And, now we're talking about, online storage. Maybe it's really fast and expensive, but now we have nearline storage where the Synology still has it available, but you start getting into the archiving game. And then, hits like Horst Schelling for offline storage. More and more people are looking at, we need access to our data. We need to have an automated access to our data, but we want it so that we can actually afford to store it. I'm actually taking a good hard look at using Synology for the Aloha Cabled Observatory by putting a smaller unit over at the cable head end, at the cable landing station, and then auto-synchronize over the WAN to a larger unit back at campus.
Right. It's funny, we've got Neo in the chat room who's saying FreeNAS for the win, and I'm big on FreeNAS. I love FreeNAS. I love building boxes for FreeNAS. But I actually did a showdown between the two, and for looking at price, performance, and overall energy usage for a given amount of storage, the Synology boxes blew FreeNAS out of the water. I couldn't get a configuration of FreeNAS that would perform as good or be as efficient as a dedicated Synology NAS. Now, Cheever, before we move on, I do want to show you this. Remember the DS414 Slim that you were slaving mm-hmm. over? Yeah, that's the tiny little four-bay NAS.
Yeah, the one I was drooling over.
Well, that's on its way, and actually, Kingston just sent me the latest batch of their new Savage SSDs, so I get to populate with these.
Right on.
I just wanted you to see that before we move on.
Yeah, you suck.
Folks, thank you very much for listening to that for our internet coverage, interop coverage. But now it's time to bring out the man of the episode. We always have so much fun when he's on, Dwight, because we learn so much. It's the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Steve Gibson. Steve Gibson from GRC.com, the maker of SpinRite, the man who is going to revolutionize the way we deal with identities and authentication as soon as Squirrel comes out. Steve, thank you very much for coming back on Twit.
Hey, great to be with you, Padre.
We brought you on specifically because of something that you talked about on Security Now this last Tuesday, and that is the next generation of DDoS attacks. Now, we are on Twit. We've been covering DDoS a lot because we've seen them on the rise over the last year. But the last year has seen a different kind of DDoS attack from the zombie army of machines, the botnets that had started off the original DDoS attacks. These were NTP and DNS amplifications. And if you need to know what those are, you could go to a previous version of Twit. But basically, it allowed someone who had as little as a 1 megabit connection to flood a source with up to 400 gigabits per second of traffic. Well, we're starting to see administrators patch their machines to prevent that sort of attack. But you've seen the rise of a new attack. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, you're right that DDoS is a concern for the enterprise. Traditionally, like 15 years ago, we were seeing so-called script kiddies who were using small botnets. That is, they were infecting other people's computers in order just to sort of blast each other off of IRC channels. And so the targets were not enterprise. The targets were other, sort of social involved IRC chatters. And so it was interesting, but it wasn't a big concern to everyone. And then, as you said, there's been an evolution to sort of looking for other ways to do this. About a month ago now, GitHub suffered a multi-day, huge denial of service attack. And it was initially puzzling to people because valid page requests were coming in from all over the world, not just from one location, and these weren't traditional DDoS reflection attacks. For example, the DNS reflection is going to generate a DNS reply and flood your bandwidth. And the same thing for an NTP reflection. It's going to generate a network time protocol enumeration reply and, again, just swamp your bandwidth. These were valid requests for pages coming in at a rate that GitHub servers could not handle, and the system became unavailable. In other words, its service was denied. So upon further examination, what was found was that these appeared to be originating from small snippets of JavaScript, which had been injected into the web pages of people all over the planet who were making some queries inside of China's main search engine. And upon further analysis, it was determined that that something located, essentially co-located where the famous Chinese firewall was, which has now been named the Great Canon, was intercepting non-HTTPS, that is plain text web browser queries, and for some JavaScript that the page wanted to have loaded, and was replacing that with malicious JavaScript. So what's so interesting about this attack is this represents essentially a whole next generation of attack. So to say this again, the idea would be that there are a number of ways this could be implemented. But for example, if a very popular site had a penetration where some of its script was changed, then everybody visiting that site, all visitors from all over the world, would have their browsers pull the whatever page they were viewing. When that page comes in, the browser parses the HTML to get all the other things, you know, JPEGs and GIFs and images and so forth. And more and more commonly, in fact, almost it's now the rule rather than the exception, is some JavaScript. So one or more script files will then be brought in and typically executed. In fact, in the case of inline script, that script expands into HTML that the browser then executes. So the idea is that if you could infect the script that a very popular website was offering, then you turn all the visitors to that website into attackers. Because what all a script has to do is essentially execute a little loop and query the target of this attack for pages faster than it's able to deliver them. I've seen actually some of this attack script, and what it does is it just spins and puts a bunch of images in line into the browser page. So this little bit of script expands to tens of thousands of image requests. The browser doesn't know it's malicious. It thinks, wow, this is a strange page, but okay. And it starts issuing queries for all those images. And when all the visitors of a popular website do that, there's no way that the server that is the target of this unprecedented query load is able to respond.
And see, this is so scary. This is scary because when we were talking about the first generation of DDoS attacks, we were talking about botnets. You had computers that were compromised in one way or another, right. But you still had to compromise them. And then you had some sort of command and control system, usually an IRC channel that they would check with to see what their target was. Right. You could take down the command and control system, or you could just clean the zombified computers.
And you could track them down by their IP addresses.
Exactly.
They were typically not spoofing their IP address. So you'd, in fact, at one point, 15 years ago, GRC was suffering from some attacks. I collected the IPs. I went to some friends at the FBI and I said, look, here's, and I did reverse DNS lookups, and there were four that were like in Orange County. And so I said, can we find out who these people are? Because they're infected and they don't know it. And I'd like to pay a house call and see what they've got. And I actually did that and managed to capture one of these bots.
If Steve Gibson comes knocking on your door, it's probably not a good thing. But then there was the second generation. The second generation was that NTP or DNS amplification attack. Now, that's just naturally going to go away as administrators start to patch their machines, their NTP and DNS boxes. But this is unique because this is not a compromised server. This is not a compromised computer. This is a browser, any browser going to a site, loading a tiny bit of JavaScript, and this traffic looks completely legit because it's coming from all these different IPs with non-infected computers.
Right. Now, the example I gave was of infecting the script on a site. That's generally, that's not something that the attackers like to rely on, because sites generally, when they find out they're infected, they get cleaned up quickly. So an alternative is to try to penetrate the the third-party source of a library, for example, node.js or jQuery. All over the internet are pages that are pulling an instance of jQuery from jQuery.com. If you could manage to turn that script malicious, it would be the mother load for attacks. But again, even though that's technically possible, and jQuery.com did suffer a site breach in 2014, the problem is, again, that's going to get cleared up quickly. So the most reliable means of perpetrating this next style of distributed JavaScript denial of service is the so-called man-in-the-middle attack. And what people need to understand is how amazingly simple this is to do. I mean, it is what this so-called great canon that the Chinese government now has available to them. This was a Chinese censorship slap on the wrist of GitHub, because the pages that were targeted were offering some software to help people avoid Chinese government censorship. So the Chinese government said, we're going to make that a little expensive, and so flooded them with page requests. What that was doing, that was a man-in-the-middle attack on non-secured pages. So they were in a position to intercept queries that were coming from browsers and alter the script. Well, anybody who can put themselves anywhere on the internet where a lot of traffic is going by. Now, that's not going to be like a coffee shop, because the only traffic you're going to see going by, if you were to intercept at all, would be the people there in the coffee shop. So maybe you got 30 laptops on a busy afternoon. What you want is you want to be at some exchange point on the internet, but those are all over the place. Technically, they're very secure, but certainly a nation state has access to its own country's internet exchange points if it wants to, just the way China does. And the one thing that these attacks so far have required is non-secured connections, because it is trivial to interject JavaScript into plain text HTML. It's just this, the browser makes a request for an HTML page, and on its way back, something inserts just a little angle bracket script tag saying, oh, go get this file over here. And when it gets into the browser obeys that command. So this is further reason to move us to SSL.
Right. I mean, you talk about how, of course, this would naturally be a lot easier to do if you had an unsecured connection, because it's easy to inject something into the stream.
Trivial.
But and you've covered this on security now. It's just a tiny bit above trivial to get a forged certificate right now.
Yes, that's the problem. It is not difficult for I am sure. We know, for example, that the Chinese government can have any certificate it wants. It has to be the case that the United States National Security Agency or FBI or CIA, that there's no question that, I mean, we have Department of Defense certificates in our computers. Those exist now. So those are certificates signed by DOD certificate authorities will be accepted by our PCs. Our browsers won't raise any alarms. Nothing will happen. And so even after we move more pervasively to SSL connections so that we are encrypting, it's still possible for a governmental agency. It's more difficult for random malicious bad guys to get a certificate. The system really works to prevent that, obviously, because we don't want anyone spoofing websites. But governments are just not going to have a problem obtaining or being able to mint certificates that our browsers trust. And when they can do that, they're able to decrypt the traffic as it flows by in a way that our browsers won't see or detect. Then while it's decrypted, they inject this tag and then re-encrypt it on its way back out.
That's got me scared more than anything else. The fact that, yeah, you're going to get the random hacker. I'm sure we're going to show it off at DEF CON this year. It's going to be used to prank people on a very short basis. But this doesn't get destructive until it becomes nation state. And as you described it, this could be a huge nation state tool.
And what happened with this great cannon was unprecedented. This was a government, and it's important to say, the forensic research has been done. Trace routes, counting router trails and packet jumps. It's absolutely verified that the great cannon technology, that packet the packet modification script inserting technology, exists between the same pair of routers on a route across the Chinese border as the Great Firewall through all of the various places where traffic crosses into China. So there's no question that this is they're in the same rack essentially. But what's disturbing is that we now have innocent bystander. I mean, innocent users of the internet having their browsers and computers and bandwidth commandeered by virtually any actor on the planet that wants to use their bandwidth to attack something else. I mean, it is the militarization of internet bandwidth.
Don't say it like that. It really does sound scary horrifying. When you say it like that. I want to bring Chee-Bert into this. Chee-Bert, you've been messing around with DNS Dane. Can that offer any help here at all?
The concept of DNS Dane is you bring the authority on who you are, the certificate authority, closer to you, and you also provide a mechanism where you can revoke certificates much, much faster. And that's one of the really big problems with SSL. It takes a while for the browsers to cycle out the blacklist certificates. There's quite a bit of work to be done. People need to have trusted DNS, so DNSSEC has to happen. And then browsers have to change in how they do it. They need to go and verify, stop trusting secondary authorities. Just only trust the authoritative DNS entry. And then associated with that will be a tag that has a certificate. It is a answer. I'm not sure if it's the answer, but it is a answer that could potentially put a stop to some of this stuff. Not sure about all, because unfortunately, man-in-the-middle attacks can do an awful lot of damage if they're put in a big enough pipe.
Yeah, Steve, I mean, that will stop the malicious hacker or two, maybe even a well-funded attacker, but even that doesn't stop a nation state, right?
Well, no, and I mean, Chee-Bert's exactly right about this notion of the evolution of DNS. I am super excited about the idea of being able to get secure DNS. If we ever get DNSSEC, what that means is that we have a general purpose secure index for the internet, which we've never had before. So for example, right now, a browser trusts a certificate because that certificate is signed by someone it trusts. But imagine if instead the browser trusts the certificate if it looks up the certificate signature using a secure DNS for that domain. That completely changes the model. It blows away the whole chain of trust and all of the problems it has, the problems of a bad certificate authority. I mean, it's radically next generation, but we don't have it yet. And although the DNS spec is in place, adoption is as slow with it as, for example, IPv6. We have that too, but nobody wants to switch to it because, it's kind of annoying and it's a pain, and IPv4 seems to be working right now in the same way that DNS is. So that's sort of that's hopeful, but even that probably doesn't solve the problem because at a nation state level, if they're able to mint certificates on the fly, they're probably also able to control the DNS routes.
You know, Steve, I want to get you, Cricket Liu, our DNSSEC expert, and Raphael Mudge, our red team, blue team expert, into a room together and just hash it out. I think that would be an absolutely phenomenal discussion. Let me bring in my other co-host here, Curtis. So you've been hopefully getting scared as you've been listening to this because, this is the evolution of that cat and mouse game. We've seen defenses against DDoSes. We've seen upstream blocking. We've seen the patching of NDP and DNS servers. And now we've got this simple code injection to create a massive DDoS attack.
It's worth mentioning we're talking hundreds of gigabits
right now. There's no defense against that.
You cannot defend. Yeah, GitHub was unable to defend against it. And they were being billed for the bandwidth, and it was racking up tens of thousands of dollars a minute in bandwidth costs. And their CDN was being hosted by Amazon, and so they were hoping that they would get, you know, some sort of forgiveness from Amazon for the bills, because they were having to pay for this bandwidth, which you know, was all malicious.
Right. But Curtis, when you hear that, you know, enterprise has typically either thrown more bandwidth at it, which Steve just explained why you can't do that because it's too expensive. They've increased the security they have upstream so they can actually stop the attacks from coming in. But looking at this kind of attack where you've got all these different IPs attacking, non-compromised computers attacking, there is no defense. I mean, have you talked about this at all on Information Week Radio?
Well, we haven't talked about it yet because it's still fairly new. The interesting thing about this is that it really does get beyond the simple nature of we're going to keep your customers from reaching you to we're going to keep your customers from reaching you and we're going to blow your budget apart. That's a nice 1-2 punch. And if you don't have ultra cooperative and ultra effective upstream providers, some of the responses are pretty brute force. And I can look back about 4 years ago, I guess it was, on a much less sophisticated DDoS attack where a company I was part of, we got hit with a major DDoS attack. And ended up, the solution involved going over with a truck, grabbing the servers and physically relocating them to a different data center on a different address map. It was, like I said, whenever your solution to a technology problem involves rented trucks, you know you're in deep territory.
I think that could be the quote of this episode. Whenever your solution involves trucks, yeah, that's not great. Gentlemen, we are unfortunately out of time. That's right. Our audience has used up another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 DDoSes. I want to thank all the panelists, my co-hosts especially, for being here, for providing the information for this week in enterprise tech. Steve Gibson, GRC.com. That's right. The man, the myth, the legend. Of course, they know that they can find you every week on Security Now here on the Twit TV network. They also know that you have been building up Squirrel. In fact, I've been holding back. I want you back in Coding 101, but I know you got to finish this project first. Here's your plug. Anything you want to talk about, sir, anything you want to tell people about, anything people should know about you or where to get in touch with you, please go.
As everyone knows, I do the podcast Security Now on Tuesdays. On Twitter, I'm at SGGRC. The product that I have been publishing for about 25 years now, as everybody knows about, is SpinRite, which is, I used it myself last week. I got a call from my operations gal who does my bookkeeping and you know, basically keeps me out of jail by paying the bills on time and my taxes and everything. Her computer had died. I'd set her up with a mirrored RAID and the instructions that if anything happened so that it, like there was a warning or something to let me know. And finally, when it collapsed, I said, well, Sue, why, you know, I don't understand how this happened. And she says, well, I was getting this message for a while that said, degraded RAID critical failure pending. Press escape to proceed. And I pressed escape and everything worked. So basically, the RAID was screaming at her that one of the two drives had failed yet it was letting her proceed, as she did until the second one failed. So the good news is I was able to use my own product, SpinRite, to pull one of the two drives back to life and rebuild her system with zero loss of data. So, you know, many people have stories about having how SpinRite saved their day. And that pays all my bills and allows me to be here with you guys.
Including me, by the way. I will say, heartfully, and I get nothing from this other than the satisfaction of telling the truth, if you don't have SpinRite in your toolbox, you don't have a toolbox.
And it's worth mentioning, too, that had we run, and I'm guilty of not running SpinRite on her machine maybe every 6 months, but it is a truly effective maintenance device. People typically don't buy it before they have a disaster. That turns them into true believers. Then they hopefully use it periodically after that. But if people were to run SpinRite on their drive, maybe quarterly or semi-annually, these problems just don't occur because SpinRite helps the drive find its own trouble and fix them or relocate sectors before they have a chance to become critically ill. So it's really useful for that as well.
Yeah. So you don't need SpinRite, I mean, if you don't care about your data. Otherwise, Steve Gibson at grc.com. Check him out. And also check out Squirrel. You're going to want to check it out. It's a very interesting project. How close are you, Steve?
Well, okay, if you were to go to grc.com/sqrl/demo.htm, up would come a working login page. It's been working for a few months. We're just working on sort of the putting on the finishing touches to this thing in order to take it public. Things like, you know, when a dialogue pops up, the input field doesn't have focus reliably because it's fighting with the browser for that. So I'm down to the short strokes, and this thing's probably, I want to say a few weeks away from going public.
Fantastic. Again, that's Steve Gibson. Go to grc.com, check out SpinRite, check out Squirrel, and follow him on Twitter at SGGRC. Steve Gibson, until next time, we thank you.
Thanks, Padre.
Of course, I need to thank my co-hosts. I wouldn't have Twyatt without them. Let's go ahead. We start with Chiebert normally, so let's start with Curtis. Curtis, where can people find you? What can people expect from Information Week Radio?
Well, we're going to continue Information Week Radio every Friday. That's going to be an ongoing thing, and we're going to be adding some nice programs over the summer. So look for more Information Week Radio to come. Also, Interop Radio continues Tuesdays. We're going to continue to bring you the voice of the IT community on radio. So please plan to join us for both of those. And if you want to know more about what was going on with SAP and Saphire, I've had several articles on that up on Information Week. There'll be some more of that in the coming week.
Curtis Franklin, thank you very much for joining us. We'll see you next week. Of course, my good friend, that's right, Chiebert. He is the Chiebert, Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Right now, a little waterlogged. Chiebert, where can people find you? What are you working on? How crazy will you be tomorrow for Minimaker?
Well, actually, the craziness starts tonight, pre-deploying different pieces of equipment and signage and all that kind of good stuff. But you'll be able to find me between 12 noon and 5 p.m. at Iolani School at the second annual Honolulu Mini Maker Fair. And I also want to do a quick shout out to my friends at SonicWall. The TZ500 is their new small business firewall that can actually keep up with Google Fiber speeds with a boatload of new CPU. And it's going to be an awesome low-end firewall.
Boot, boot. Gentlemen, thank you, one. Thank you all. Also, thanks to you. That's right, to our loyal listener, the person who watches, listens, downloads each and every single week. We wouldn't have a show without you, and, well, I just love doing Twyatt. So we want to do something for you. We want to make it easy for you to get every episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech into your device of choice. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/Twyatt. There you'll find our entire back catalog of episodes. If you want to see what we did at Interop 2015, if you want to see the Interop preview, if you want to see what we did with Pin Drop Security, their acoustical technology that allows them to know whether or not a call is fraudulent, you can find it all right there at twit.tv/twiet. And as long as you're there, why not use the little drop-down menus where you can get every episode in the format of your choice into your device of choice. If you want it on your iPhone, your iPad, your Android tablet, your Mac, your PC, your laptop, your desktop, we've got a format for you. Also, please don't forget that we do this show live every week at Friday, 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time. Just go to live.twit.tv. You can watch the pre-show, the post-show, and everything in between. And as long as you're watching, why not jump into the chat room at irc.twit.tv? I've got you in a little box, a little screen right above my camera so that I can find out what you're doing during the show. We can interact. You can ask questions of the guests. You can tell us what you get, what you don't get, what you want to see in the future. It's a great way to be part of the experiment that is Twit TV. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter. Just go to twitter.com/PadreSJ. If you follow me there, you'll see what we're going to be doing for every episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, as well as all the other shows I do on the Twit TV network, and you'll be able to suggest guests and topics for future shows. It's a great way to communicate with me. Next week, we're going to be bringing in another interop bit from SonicWall. That's right, we're going to be talking about SonicWall's new TZ line of routers and security appliances. But until then, I want to thank everyone here in the studio who makes this show possible. To Lisa, to Leo, to Carson, my super producer. And of course, to my TD. That's right, it's Eskimo Zach. Zach, can you tell the folks where they can find you on the Twit TV network?
Thank you, Padre. Yes, of course, you guys can find me on Twitter. That's Eskimozach.
There we go. Thank you very much. And I'm Father Robert Ballecer. And until next time, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep quiet.